This video is brought to you by Squarespace. When it comes to websites, online stores, etc., there's no place to build a beautiful online presence like Squarespace. There's something about Uncut Gems that I just can't get enough of. I've seen it 4 times now, and each watch makes me feel like I'm getting bitten by a mosquito every 3 seconds while also stepping on Legos and undergoing a terrible migraine and also at a dance club, and also apparently the pizza I was cooking earlier has been in there for 10 minutes longer than it needed to be, and it gets better every time. Everyone's talked about the technical achievements of this film by now, the phenomenal sound design, the claustrophobic cinematography, and even I've touched on the deceptively nuanced performance by Adam Sandler from time to time. But upon watching it a fourth time, I gotta talk about the structure of this film, and one scene in particular that really stands out, and in a lot of ways summarizes what is so great about this movie. If you know what you're getting into with Uncut Gems, you know that this movie is essentially about a guy having a really bad time, and in some ways it can feel repetitive. Like, he goes home, something goes wrong, and he goes to the club, and something goes wrong, and he's at his daughter's play, and something goes wrong. It really captures this feeling of being trapped, watched, being on edge no matter where you go, which is why, in many ways, it's a fantastic depiction of addiction told through a gambler's perspective, in a way that draws the viewer in an extremely authentic way that at times feels really uncomfortable. But there's one scene in there that feels like it takes the time to understand Howard, and it's the one where he doesn't talk for an entire sequence. It's the auction scene. For some context, for anyone who hasn't seen the film, at this point Howard is at an auction for this opal he bought from some people in Ethiopia. The opal was appraised at around 155 grand when it was originally supposed to be around $1 million, but thankfully, Howie invited Gooey and his son to meet Kevin Garnett at the auction. The plan? Have Gooey up the bid on the opal, assuming Kevin Garnett ups the bid as well, so that Howard can earn more than the original appraisal. But here's what happens. Howard's in there, Gooey's in there, and KG's in there. I think the placement of these characters to begin with has a lot to do with why this scene works so well. Howard is situated somewhere on the right side, near the back, most of his attention is directed towards KG, who doesn't look back at Howard once this entire scene, and on the left side is Gooey, parallel to Howie. Their dynamic, on the other hand, is a lot different than Howard and KG. Howard is reliant on KG, sure, but KG's drive in this is directed towards the opal, situated at the front of the room. Howard is also reliant on Gooey in this scenario, though, but Gooey being here because of KG, which is because of Howard, puts him lower in this order of power, giving Howard the command over him. So the auction starts off relatively slow, 40,000 to 50, 50 to 60, and all of a sudden Kevin Garnett says 100,000. This is good, we're talking some pretty good numbers at this point, such good numbers that one of the original bidders backs out, and with that kind of confidence, Howard should feel pretty good about KG taking home the final bid. But then Arlo and Phil walk in, the people that kind of put Howard in this uncomfortable position to begin with, a physical reminder of the stakes that are riding on this auction. Their placement in the scene is in the back of the room, rightfully so, as they are the primary reason for why most of this is something to worry about in the first place. They're kind of at the top of the power rankings, from what we know of. Coincidentally, as soon as that threat enters the room, that's when things get scarier for Gooey as well, as he has to start bidding himself. All of a sudden, it feels a lot more serious. With each hand raise, Gooey has another $20,000 in this deal. Things are on track until they hit 170 grand. That's when KG's advisor whispers, "We agreed nothing past 175, and that leads me into a quick side note. This is one of the very few times during the scene that someone besides the auctioneer says something, and it really speaks to how tense the Safdies are able to go with such little sound. You can owe this to two things, one being the editing in this scene, which not only spends no more than 3 seconds on each shot, but also consistently cuts back to Howard with every chance it gets. Most of the scene, as proven by the framing of the shots, is either told through Howard's perspective or the auctioneer's. While it may not be cars honking or doors buzzing, that tone of voice from the auctioneer matches the anxiety of those other sounds, and by cutting between shots from his perspective as well as Howard's, we feel in the middle of what is basically a tornado. For a lot of the movie, the Safdies put the viewer in the room, but in this scene, we're more in Howard's head, and get a full grasp on how many things can be rushing through it at once. The second thing is the choice of going silent with this scene, which only works this well because of how deep into the film we are. By this point, it's been well established how Howard thinks, and more importantly, how he talks. It's almost like getting a song stuck in your head, or like that weird floating arm doorway trick. That annoying voice of his has been so stitched into our brains at this point that the movie is confident enough with this silence that you can almost hear what Howard would be thinking. His face is so easy to read, and it's that familiar understanding the film bestows onto the audience that draws you in just that much more. Okay, but where were we? KG does bump it up to 180, followed by GUI bumping it up even more, but KG backs out after that. And just like that, GUI paid a lot of money for something he didn't want. KG is without an opal, Arno and Phil are pissed, and Howard is just on quite literally everyone's bad side. It's this chain of events that happens all at once that breaks Howard, leaving him bruised, wet, bloody, defeated, and in more danger than he's ever been. Like I said, Uncut Gems is a movie about an addict, and this is a crucial scene in understanding his eventual relapse. A lot of the stress from the viewer might come from the lack of understanding for why someone would continue to throw themselves into these insane risks, especially the biggest one that comes at the end of the movie. But this scene, the catapult that launches Howard into his lowest point, gives reason for these choices, and proves how aware Howard really is of what he's doing the whole time. For one, it's one of the only scenes in the film where Howard isn't in complete control of his actions. The outcome of this relies on KG's hands, only for him to be easily influenced by his advisor. And for KG to get to that number, Howard is also reliant on GUI to push the bid. An important thing to note, though, is that while Howard was unsuccessful because of KG, he did successfully manage to get GUI to push the bid like he was supposed to. To be fair, it didn't go as planned, but he did do what he was told to do. There was a sense of power in this scene, and while the audience's general takeaway for that scene is, well, that was a disaster, Howard's takeaway is coming from his ego, that he was able to control GUI, but more importantly, that KG is also more controllable than he thought, which of course gives reason for the climactic scene with KG at the end of the film, you know, the famous one. But the thing is, as I've kind of hinted at, you can say a lot of the same stuff about most scenes in Uncut Gems. The meticulous editing and creative sound design, the choice of where to put the actors and how to frame them, the lack of control that Howard has for most of the film. It's this consistent style that makes Uncut Gems such a polarizing yet rich film. So why talk about the auction scene specifically? See, yes, Uncut Gems is about addiction, and it tells the story of an addict by throwing us into his downward spiral. But at some point, the film needs to step back as a means of understanding the addict. Much of the horrible things that happened to Howard in the film can be attributed to bad luck, or to taking too big of a risk. I mean, if it wasn't for KG holding onto the gem for so long, or for Damani being hard to work with, at least some of this wouldn't be so horrible. You can't call all of this Howard's fault. Also, Howard doesn't actually know how well KG will play in a game. So much of the thrill is up to chance. But in the auction scene, while this is out of Howard's control, it's also not up to chance. KG said just like two scenes ago that he would only buy it off of him for like $170,000. It's been established that KG won't go past that, and it shouldn't actually come as a surprise in the scene that KG would back out this soon. Which makes you think, Howard in a lot of ways knew this wasn't going to work out, yet he put his father-in-law in danger, he kept the opal from KG, and he upset Arno and Phil even more. And that happens in a lot of scenes in the movie where you're like, maybe this didn't need to happen. Maybe Howard is doing this intentionally. So obviously, why would he do this? Well, Uncut Gems understands that addicts, like Howard, at a certain point aren't in it for the financial compensation or whatever it is that they're into. What they're in it for is flying as close to the sun as you can and the high and adrenaline that comes with that. It's the act of going so far down one tunnel that you almost disassociate from who you are and the life around you. Like he said, you want to win by 1 point or fucking 30 points? If there's one thing that this auction scene proves, it's that this isn't just how Howard wins, it's how he survives. Hey everyone, thank you for watching. It's been a while since I've made a video essay where it's like a, you know, a video essay. And to do one on this movie, which is one of my favorite movies, it just was so much fun. So glad I finally got to do a video on this. Before you head out, I want to give a quick thank you to this week's sponsor, Squarespace. Now, Squarespace, if you didn't already know, is a place where you can go online to build your brand, whether that be through an online store, a blog, a portfolio. It's basically the best place to go if you're looking to take that next step and put together a beautiful website. Squarespace has a wide array of award-winning designer templates to make whatever that website is look fantastic, and they have 24-hour customer service to walk you through any issues that you run into. Basically, if you're looking to take that next step and, you know, finally jump into this, now's a great time to do so, because if you go to squarespace.com/Karsten, you can get 10% off of your first purchase. So really, there's no reason, you know, not to give it a shot if you haven't already. So thanks again to Squarespace for sponsoring this video. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you all in the next one.